Q.
I got something here. I want to see if you know what this is.
A Q.
A cue. That's right.
Yeah, I like that.
Hello and welcome from deep inside Jolly Roger's studio. This is the Q Filmcast, and whether you're listening online worldwide or perhaps nationwide on one of our affiliate stations, thanks as always for tuning in. If it's your first time with us, let me tell you what we do. We are the show which brings to you our review of a particular film currently streaming on Netflix Instant. We gather here each week, Jolly Roger's studio, where we go around the table to tell you what we thought. All of that and our weekly top three list, inspired by the movie in question. This week, episode 52.
One year.
That's 52 weeks in a year?
Yeah, sometimes.
This year.
This year.
Actually, if you count how many times we sat around this table, it's more like 53, right? Or maybe 54. Had a couple mulligans in there in the early stages. But this is episode 52, one-year anniversary here.
We soldier on.
And not only is it episode 52, it's also episode 4 of our family plan.
The family plan.
It's double special today. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
You double, know what family is. Max, explain family plan, Max.
You take friends and family and you merge them into one and you get family.
Family plan.
That's where we let all of our friends and or family pick a film to queue up on the show and we review it for them and tell them whether it sucked or we loved it.
Okay, I take it like there are three special things on this show.
One is Max.
Then right back to gumbo we go. Your show, man. You passed the ball to someone. Let's reveal that. Who is it, and what film are we digging into this week, Max?
It's my sister, Kim. Lives in Florida.
Ooh.
Hot, muggy, miserable, humid Florida.
Sounds
that's
delicious.
What she likes. So she, I threw it to her because she's got pretty good taste. I said, hey, pick a movie for us to watch on Netflix. And she said, ask me all these qualifying questions. I said, let's just pick something for crying out loud.
Nobody in movies.
And it had to be something good. So she picked The Diving Bell and The Butterfly.
The Diving Bell and The Butterfly. Actually, we've had a couple people.
Yeah, fun fact, my sister picked the same movie.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, I did the same thing. She picked the same movie, so.
But I was first, so I win.
Oh, yeah, I smacked her. It's okay.
Yeah, I'm going to go one.
But I know his sister, and so I said, okay, well, this must be a pretty good movie, because I know my sister, too, so I'm like, okay, I'm down with this.
Yeah, this really is keeping it in the family, man, no doubt about it.
I feel like your brother now.
Oh, how nice. How nice. I actually take it one further. Not too long ago, someone tweeted and requested that we review this film. Got some heat on this one. Cue up Diving Bell and the Butterfly. We're going to dive into it, too.
Right?
Yeah. And we're going to fly away.
With some butter. Bells.
You have to be a caterpillar first, Max. You know that.
I will spread my wings.
Got to crawl before you can fly.
Yeah. So once again, I'm Michael, as always. And to my left, look at this. James Hardsub Savage.
What's up, Maestro?
Did you see his ears just perk right up when you said that?
Yeah, he looked like a dog, too. He's got
the Pavlov thing on you.
Yeah, like
to
the Pavlov
left, and ears just perked right up.
Give him
a treat already.
Always so excited to see you, man.
What's up, Maestro?
Even when you're wearing a lovely shirt.
Yeah.
I love
sea foam.
A little bit of sea foam green going on.
There you go. Brings out my eyes.
It does. Brings out one eye, James. Just one. And to your left, and that makes sense later, to your left, Matt, the patron saint of quality outerwear. That's Matthew St. Hoodie.
Hi. Hey.
Always the same response. Hi. Always snarking. I love it.
Hey.
Did you like your shirt?
It's sea foamy.
Yeah.
It kind of goes with the flow of the movie.
There you go.
So it's a very appropriate shirt. Right. Well played, James.
We're going to round this out with the producer, Adam the Bomb Rogers.
Hey, hey.
What was that?
Bonjour.
Are you Dwayne bonjour. From What's Happening?
Wah, 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 wah. Yeah.
Right.
G-Raj. All right. So here we are. Q Filmcast talking about 2007's Diving Bell and the Butterfly. Real quickly, how to keep up with us any way you want. You can Google it. You'll find something. Facebook, Twitter, iTunes, whatever. You need to go to our website. thequfilmcast.net. Yeah, you want to go there. Qfilmcast.net. We like feedback. So let's get into the meat of this one here, and let's cue up the conversation.
Ooh.
What do you say?
I say we.
I say we. I say truly, oh, Lord.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, my wife says I'm starting to talk like you more and more. She's mentioned this several times. She goes, you sound like Max, they. I just did that. I said truly, oh, Lord. That's something
I'm an influential kind of guy that way.
Yeah.
I say, well, Lord.
Let's see how this movie influenced us here. And this is one with a little bit of a depth to it.
Oh.
It's deep. You would need a diving bell
I thought it was more deep. Uplifting.
Okay. Well, yeah, like a butterfly.
Buoyant.
Got it. Yeah, got it. Oh,
I didn't know we'd be able to do that with this.
There you go.
Just with the title. Right.
Do you know that people who liked this film also liked My Left Foot?
Shocker.
Name of the Father. Huh? Mm-hmm. A Beautiful Mind.
I can see that.
And, okay. Of course, you know, Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind.
I can see that, too.
Well, if they make a sequel to My Left Foot, what would it be?
My Right Foot.
There you go.
It would be the most boring movie in the world.
It's the whole thing, but it's his other foot.
That does nothing.
This film was directed by Julian Schnable.
Schnable.
Did I say that right, Hoodie?
Mm-hmm.
You know this guy. You brought up some facts about this guy. We can talk about that in a minute if you want.
Oh, no.
All right, you want to leave it there? Okay. He directed Diving Bell and the Butterfly. Basquiat?
Basquiat.
Basquiat.
I sound like an idiot. Basquiat? Basquiat. What's the soup noodger? Sorry. I don't know. I've never seen the guy's work other than this.
Munich. You've seen Munich, right? Eric Bana?
Well, that was a Steven Spielberg film.
Steven Spielberg
what?
Movie.
Is it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
This guy did a movie, Munich, right?
He may have, but it wasn't that one.
No.
Not the one you're thinking of.
Oh, okay.
Unless you've seen the other movie called
Munich. No, there is
you're
another
thing. You're thinking of the actor who was in Munich.
Well, Eric Bana?
No, I'm looking at your actor. Notes. It says Munich.
Oh, no. That stars Mathieu Amalric. He was in Quantum of Solace. Yeah, it stars him. He was in Quantum of Solace. He was in Munich. That's where you're getting that confused.
My bad. That's where it is.
See what happens when you cheat. Savage. You look at someone else's notes. You don't always get the right answer.
He's a good bad guy, too.
This guy was in the Grand Budapest Hotel. Didn't see it.
I did. Mm-hmm. I was watching the thing. I know that guy from somewhere. And then I was like, hey, he looks like Roman Polanski.
I'm not going to attempt who else is in it. Other people are in it.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Bunch of French folk.
Roman Polanski's wife.
The blonde.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Look at that, coming back with the trivia. All right, well, this did inspire our top three. They all do. All these films inspire our top three. This is no different. This inspired our top three. And Hoodie, you came up with this, and I loved it. I perked up when you threw this one at me, because I'm like, that's good. You're talking about My Body is a Prison movie. You get the concept here. And it certainly goes in line with this film.
Sure. Yeah.
Because this guy, you know what he was in? He was locked in, and we're locked into this
show. It's almost like a syndrome.
Almost. Stroke of genius.
I should have used that earlier. We're locked into it. Now we're locked into this one. All right, so let's get into the ratings on this. Usually what we'll do is we'll go over to the critics real quick, tell you what they thought, and let's do that right here. Go over to IMDb. What do you think they gave this one, Savage?
I'll pretend I can't see your notes and say 90.
90. Well, you're using the wrong scale. This is 8.1.
See? Then I can't see your notes.
Okay. 8.1
on IMDb.
They
were wrong before.
Cheating has trapped you once again.
Jeez, man. Right. Okay. Oh, 8.1. Yeah, but you're right, though. It's up there.
That's a good number.
Rotten Tomatoes.
90.
Go a little higher. Right? Really? You've got critics at 93, users at 90.
92.
Oh. It's basically a tie.
See, now your cheating is rubbing off on me.
93 and 92.
So it's pretty good.
Yeah, it's not bad. That's a fresh film.
It's almost in line. That's pretty nuts too.
Wow. Everybody kind of likes this film. Okay. No one, I don't see people hating this film, you know, in vast amounts. So yeah.
Right.
People like it. We had some requests for it. The family wanted to see it. The family wanted to get to it. So that's what we did. And let's talk about what this film is. Gumbo, what you got?
All right. Here's what you have. As Michael would say, the astonishing true life story of Jean-Dominic Bauby, a man who was...
It's pronounced Booby.
A booby?
Okay.
The astonishing true life story of Jean-Dominic Bauby, a man who held the world in his palm, lost everything to sudden paralysis at the age of 43, and somehow found the strength to rebound. This story was first received in Bauby's best-selling autobiography, The Diving Bell and the Butterfly, then in Jean-Jacques Beineix's half-hour 1997 documentary of the same title. 10 years after that, Julian Schnabel helms the camera in this full-length motion picture. The movie follows Bobby's story to the letter, his instantaneous descent from a wealthy and congenial playboy and the editor of French Elle to a bedbound, hospitalized stroke victim with an inactive brainstem that made it impossible for him to speak or move a muscle of his body. This prison, as it were, became a kind of diving bell for Bobby, one with no means of escape. With the editor's mind unaffected, his only solace lay in the butterfly of his seemingly depthless fantasies and memories. Because of Bobby's physical restriction, he only possessed one channel for communication with the outside world, ocular activity. By moving his eyes and blinking, he not only began to interact again with the world around him, but, astonishingly, authored the said memoir via a code used to signify specific letters of the alphabet.
That's it?
That's it.
Oh, that's fantastic. Everybody wake up.
Sounds about right. Yeah, sounds about
wake up, wake up. Okay, so there you go. That's it. 2007 Butterfly and the Diving Bell. Said that completely ass backwards.
Yep.
Here you go. Here's a bit of a flavoring of Diving Bell and the Butterfly. We'll come back, tell you what we thought of this one. Here you are.
Old man! My great bundle of sweet mace. It is love, love, love at sight first. No, is it not? No, yes? Oh, the mad rush of hot blood to the temples. Ah, golden girl, you are the corned beef to me. I am the cabbage to you.
Okay, so there you go. There's a piece, a bit of essence, a bit of inspiration
right.
from the film we're going to get into tonight, 2007. The French film, Diving Bell and the Butterfly. And before we tell you what we thought, let's get into a little bit of facts about this thing real quick. Julian Schnable, the director of this film, did you know he learned French to make it?
Whoa. No.
That's impressive. Insane.
That is kind of impressive.
That is impressive. I think he's Swiss.
Oh, look at me.
No, I'm sorry. Never mind. I think he is anyway. He didn't know French. I know that.
Yeah, that's dedication if I've ever heard
it. You're right.
That's almost like Will Ferrell learning Spanish for Casa de
Mi Padre. He was born in Brooklyn.
Okay, never mind.
Schnable?
He maybe had a Swiss
parent. That's even more impressive because Europeans are generally polylinguistic.
To familiarize himself with Bauby's sheltered existence, director Schnable made the movie in the same hospital where he was treated, meeting many of the orderlies that had actually treated him. He also shot scenes in the same balcony where Bauby relaxed and on the same nearby beach his family took him.
Wow.
Wow, I didn't know that.
That makes sense.
So that actually adds to the movie a little bit, I think.
It does add to the movie.
So he's a method director.
Well, I tell you, he's a pretty dedicated director. Don't give me a set. Don't give me a bad grab. We're going there.
There you go.
Yeah, so that's interesting. Yeah, I thought that was nice. Julian Schnable originally considered making the film in English with Gary Oldman or Johnny Depp in the lead.
Wow.
The French really added a whole lot to it, I think.
You know what I'm learning? I don't like, if I'm going to watch a film about France, speak French to me. I don't like it when you, all of a sudden, I'm hearing English with a with an English accent.
Right. Or a French accent.
Or a French accent. It was such a romantic movie, too. The French really lent.
Yeah.
To that.
Yeah, I'm with you on that, so I'm glad they didn't go down that road. Johnny Depp was originally cast to play this part. Dropped out at the last minute because he was conflicted in his schedule with filming Pirates of the Caribbean at World's End.
But he speaks fluent French, though.
I have no idea.
That's the best thing I can say about that movie.
That it didn't.
It kept him from doing this one.
You know what, though? I'm thinking if he would have been in this role, I can see him doing this. I can see this as a launching pad somewhat for his film palette. Yep. I think people would have gravitated to this film more, for sure.
Yeah.
I still think Jonah Hill would have done a good job, too.
I was going to learn French.
Hill and the Butterfly.
Diving Hill. I picture every movie with what's his name? Jonah Hill. Right. Yeah. Currency. Yeah, because we don't use thumbs up, thumbs down. We don't use 1 to 10, just anything.
No.
We go a little creative than that. In essence of the film and in respect to the film, we're going to use 1 to 10 blinks.
There you go.
Eye blink.
No, single eye blink. And let's get into that.
Yeah.
Let's talk about what we thought of this film. We know the critics liked it.
Right.
We know your sister liked it.
His sister liked it.
Yeah. We know that dude that tweeted us liked it. Sure. We know Johnny Depp wasn't too impressed with it. Go, Max. 1 to 10. Blink them out. Don't actually blink. Just tell me the dang number.
This is a tough one. I'm going to go 8 blinks on this one. I might be able to move. I might move up some, but I'm going to give it 8 blinks right now. Extremely effective movie. Very effective in what it did and what it was setting out to do. Mm-hmm. It worked on every level.
I think it could have failed, too. That's what made it impressive.
Well, yeah. Any movie like this that could get so over-sentimental and stuff like that, it's destined to fail. It's destined to become a chick flick.
Yeah.
And this one didn't do that.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, so 8 for you. You're blinking out 8 at me, and we're going over to Matthew St. Hoodie, and I want to know what you got.
I got 7 for basically the same reasons Max gave it an 8, almost exactly. Just a little lower. I don't know how that worked out.
You'll go up.
Nah. Are you peeking at his notes?
You didn't hate the film.
No, I liked
it. No doubt about
it. I liked it, but, can't explain it. We'll get into it.
Look at this. Very pensively, thinking about what he may or may not tell us. That is James Hartsub Savage. What you got, man? What you going with?
No, I agree with Max to a degree. This movie can fail, and it did fail with me.
Yep.
I'm going with a 4.
A 4? Man, that's down there.
Yeah. And the reason I do that is because, 5 is an even thing, and you'd have to recommend it. 6, you would watch it again.
Mm-hmm.
I won't. And 5, I would recommend it. I can't.
Yeah, seven, so you start four. Talking about it. Eight, right. you start championing it.
Yeah. Right. You're wearing okay. a seafoam colored shirt.
Yeah, you know, that's just fashionable.
No. Shocked.
Adam, blow my mind, man. Blink out your review or your rating for The Diving Bell and Butterfly.
I had a religious experience in this for this movie.
All right.
And it was one of me suffering in hell.
Okay.
Right.
I hated it.
Really? Was it because it was in French?
No. Well, actually a little bit, and I'll get into that here in a little
but
bit.
But you hated this film. Excoriated it. Couldn't horrible. Stand it.
If I want to watch someone suffering, I'd rather watch me watching this movie, suffering watching it.
Did you have Ichi syndrome?
I hated it. No.
Did you have Ichi syndrome? All right, well, give me the number.
Three.
Three. Right. Oh, well,
just
okay.
because they attempted to make a movie.
Okay, because they attempted to make a movie.
And just for the record, I'd really like to watch Adam watching this movie and suffering, too. So if we could get that going, I think right. we could probably kickstart this.
God, that's fantastic. Our first ever video cast. We do a video podcast for that. All right, so that leaves it to me. Let me round this thing out. I'm on a roll here. I've been liking some movies lately.
Yeah.
And I didn't really want to at this one. I thought, okay, enough of the love for the films. But, yeah, I'm going to go up nine. I'm going to go nine on this. Right. I like this film because not so much the way the movie was made, but the way the story was told. A bit of a difference there in my mind.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm going with this story is told as perfectly as I think they could tell it. I'm up there with nine. I'm blinking out. Nine.
That's 31 blanks.
I need a Visine. My eyes are red from blinking. My one eye. My one eye is red from blinking.
Your one eye is red from blinking. That's 31 it. Blanks.
How many we get?
31.
Are you sure? Yeah, because Adam Sandbag, producer.
Well, hey, James only
got four. I hate what I hate.
Yeah, I guess so. It is only 31. Okay, we'll see what we can do about that. We had a few liking it, one not liking it, one excoriating it. So let's go over to the one that let it off.
I'm not that far from him. No. Come on.
Yeah, I know.
There'll be different reasons.
We'll see. Let's go back to the one that that actually started the whole thing going, and that is Max Gumbo Johnson. Eight for this, you say?
I gave it an 8, yes.
Go ahead.
Eight.
Why? Tell me.
First off, talking about that thing where he was going to make it in English, I don't like to watch foreign movies when they're dubbed.
I can't stand it.
I used to have to watch them dubbed because I hated reading subtitles. It's more I got into watching foreign movies. You kind of get the opposite. I'd much rather see it subtitled. This one was one exception where I wouldn't mind watching this again in a dubbed version because so much of the time my eye was taken away from the visuals that I just shut up. You didn't like the movie, so I don't want to hear from you. My eye was taken away from the visuals that were so interesting to look at through the first 46 minutes of the movie where everything was told from his point of view pretty much. The subtitles got distracting a little bit.
Yeah.
It was like, okay, I appreciate the subtitles, but I really would like to see this in a dubbed version so I can really pay attention to what's going on screen. That first 45 minutes was fascinating. At first, the first 10 minutes or so, I was sitting there watching. I was like, God, I hope they don't do this through the whole movie.
God, I thought the same exact thing.
I was like, I cannot watch this. I'm getting seasick. Yeah. My eyes. Yeah, I was like, what is going on? I can't. Is there something wrong with my eyes? Is this going to be blurry the whole time? Yeah. Like
which
this?
Is obviously why he did it.
Yeah.
Put you in that position.
It worked out fantastic.
Yeah, and it worked great. And, you know, after a few minutes, you get used to it and you kind of feel, you get in flow with it.
Yeah.
And it worked like gangbusters, I think. And the other thing. Up until 43 minutes, you never see the guy. That was the first time they showed him, was at about the 43-minute mark. I actually paused it to see, okay, how long into the movie are we?
And I did that too.
Yeah.
Was it 43 or 46 minutes?
That was about 43 minutes.
Yeah. The storytelling was good. Is it sort of a cliched story of this inspirational character that, you know, overcame such great odds? And blah? Yeah, it is sort of a cliched sort of thing. But to take something like that and make something so completely fresh like this, it's phenomenal that he was able to pull that off and do something so unique with it that it stood out among those types of films.
I think it
totally does stand out among those types of films.
I'm with you, man. I don't think the director took the bait like he could have many times.
No, he could have made something like that piece of crap that, what's that Julia Roberts movie, Dying Young.
Which that's exactly
I hate,
it.
I hate movies like that. Yeah. It's just, it's so sad, so romantic, and blah, blah, blah. No, it's not romantic. It's pulling at your heartstrings, and it's manipulating
you. And that's what I mean by take the bait.
This movie never manipulated you in any way whatsoever, as far as I was concerned.
All right, it almost did.
It almost did. In one scene, it really got to me.
No, there was a bunch of scenes where it really rode that line.
There was one scene I thought that...
Well, let's talk
it
about
did that.
That
line, but I'll tell you what that is later.
I'm feeling a little verklempt over here. Is that a tear rolling down, or are you just blinking too much over there?
Who knows?
There you go, Savage. No, react to what Max said. Go ahead.
Well, I don't want to give the impression that I hated it.
You sure did.
You did. You gave it a 4.
Well, but hate is a real strong word. Clearly,
you said ineffective.
Right. It's clearly a tragic story, and because it's true, it's even more tragic. I kind of didn't like it, and I found it ineffective for the very reasons that Max did like it. The first 10 minutes I was with you, it's like, oh, man, I can't. This is going to wear thin really quickly. Mm-hmm. And then once the kind of the blurring stopped and you kind of saw, and I thought it was a neat effect. It's like his internal dialogue that he thought he was having but wasn't having with people. It's like, you can't hear me. Hey, doctor, I'm talking to you. I'm telling you my name.
Oh, that was fabulous.
Yeah, no, that was really good. I thought, okay, man, if you do this, I'm kind of on board. But then it just another 30 minutes of this viewpoint, man, that gimmick wore thin on me quickly.
See, I didn't think they kept it up that long. I thought they were very restrained with that.
They did.
Go ahead, Seb. I'm sorry to mean it.
Yeah, no, I mean, they didn't get into a third-person viewpoint until 43 minutes. Mm-hmm. And really, it was like almost 50 minutes before it was like the omniscient, where you look down like a typical film, the scene with his mm-hmm. father. That was when it was like classic film look, you know, instead of that one-eye vision thing. And then once the alphabet thing started, that wore thin on me. The monotone throughout the whole film from then on. Once that started, man, that was that just kicked it through all the way through the film. Apparently, researching it, it's not even very accurate. The story isn't very accurate.
I've heard that said a bit, yeah.
But, so, I mean, obviously this guy really had locked-in syndrome, which is a horrible, horrible thing to happen to you. But the relationships weren't very real. It's like apparently his girlfriend was there and not his wife. So it did kind of color this picture of this guy, the relationship that he had isn't inaccurate.
I've heard that it's accurate enough. I've also seen people say, you know, obviously there's going to be some liberties there.
Sure, sure, sure.
You know, but all these people were there. They were affected, maybe not at the time and at the place, but the essence of the film is intact.
That's still surprising. Just you talking about how dedicated Schnabel was to, you know, learning and depicting this, that he would make it inaccurate. I didn't know that.
Yeah. I mean, well, that's one of the knocks on the film. I mean, I don't know the truth of that. That's what I've read. Other than that, the story is like, it's, I don't want to say off the rack, you know, but it does court this sentimentality thing. I thought the scenes with his father was really good. I really liked his car at the end, but it just didn't hit me. It didn't resonate with me at all, you know, and especially the gimmick, the one eye thing, that I think that's more than anything. That's what that turned me off of it.
I sensed a lot of restraint from that. The minute I thought I had enough, it went away. And also the monotony that you say of her reading those letters. Yeah. I wanted to sense some monotony there. I mean, the guy didn't want the person you're watching go through this. He didn't want to hear it any more than I did.
No,
I needed to sense some of that monotony. I needed to sense the fact that, okay, he's probably feeling like I am right now, which is you're killing me with this. I think that worked for the film.
Well, I mean, that's just where we part ways.
Yeah.
I think as a filmmaker, there are better options for that. I mean, with subject matter like this, I don't think being dedicated to these two devices, one visual, one auditory.
Right.
I didn't think that served the subject matter or the story.
Producer, you anything you want to add other than it sucked and it was boring? You don't have to add anything.
No. I'm going with James. The whole eye-opening thing for the first 40 minutes, it just got to me and got to me. Other than the suturing of the eye, that was the only time I was like,
I figured it would be.
Yeah. Usually when I watch a foreign movie, I like something going on to distract me from the subtitles.
Okay.
You know, kind of.
So you don't like to read.
Yeah. And this whole entire time is I'm reading, and nothing interesting is happening on the screen for me.
Well, because it's so internal, Adam. Yeah. It's an existential theme. It's internal, you know.
And it never happens, really. I mean,
that was really one of my favorite parts, though. I know what you're saying.
I mean, that's just me. I just don't want to read dialogue. It's like listening to you guys all the time. All right. In my head, I want to get shut up.
Yeah, yeah. You wanted more bombs and whistles. I got it.
No, okay. I'm just, you know.
Just whoa.
And Adam, I think this is a great film if you want to learn French, because you learn the alphabet really quickly.
I can count to 10 in French.
That was German.
I think so.
I think it was. Maybe he had the wrong subtitles on.
There you go.
Hoodie, you gave this a 7. What did you like?
I can see what James is saying. I can see what Max is saying. I think not exactly in the middle, but I kind of ride that line. As much as I liked the first 40 minutes, and that, I think that was definitely the strongest part of the movie, the opening was just awesome, I thought. I did think that it took away from the movie at certain parts, too. I really liked how Schnabel chose to frame shots using, you know, the movement of the pupil. I thought that was really interesting. On the flip side of that, it did kind of annoy me at certain times, which, you know, that's really weird. The thing you like most about it is the thing that really, at certain points, you just don't like. But the story, I don't think the story is all that cliche. I can't think of another movie that really is laid out for me in this kind of format. So I don't think it's...
Well, when I say cliche, let me explain. Mm-hmm. I meant in that sentimental heartstring, I will overcome way.
You know what? It didn't come off like that because they had to, make him kind of think like that. It was kind of nice to see him go through that transition because you had him at the beginning saying, I want to die.
Yeah.
And I was, you know, when he said I was like, dude wants to die. I would absolutely want to be dead too. There's no way I'd want to live like that.
I did want to watch while I was watching this movie.
Yeah, we get it. But then when he's talking to his friend Laurent and he's trying to do the alphabet thing, but he's doing it wrong.
Yeah.
And he's like, he's laughing in his head.
You gotta look at me, yeah.
Yeah, he's like, you're not looking. You didn't even see. And he's like, haha, you're so funny. Yeah. And I was like, oh, this guy's... He's now getting a sense of humor, and that kind of him going through the movie and almost accepting it, you know, up to the build up where he's writing the book and getting into it, and that's what he thinks about laying in the bed, you know, watching the static on the television. I thought that was probably the most interesting part, was him just accepting what's happened to him and trying to make amends with everybody that he's not, you know, not only wronged in his life, but hasn't, you know, said, I love you. Like Max was saying, I think that it really rode that line very nicely. Like, he could have definitely gone overboard with that. And I think it did maybe push it a little bit further than I would have, but I'm not as smart as Julian Schnable.
So. Oh, I don't know.
So
you're way smarter than that guy.
Oh, no.
He was smart enough to pass on Johnny Depp. I think that's what Max was saying. All right. So, it leaves it to me, right? Tell you what I thought. I'm up high on this thing.
Yeah.
I'm 9.
You are 9.
I'm a champion in this film. I don't care. Because I didn't know. I didn't think I'd like it. I thought, same thing. Sentimental, man. What are you going to feed me?
Right.
You know, you're putting something on the menu here I'm not in the mood for. But let me tell you something, man. I could go down the immediate road and talk about what the film is, how it made me feel. Because it's ripe with that. I mean, that's what it's... In the end, you think that's what you're going to talk about. But to me, it's just a beautiful piece of work. It somehow finds a way to uplift me more than it does depress me. You know what I'm talking about?
That's a thing, too.
Yeah, it really did uplift me. It's magic in that regard. The performances, I could go on about that. Fantastic. I liked everybody in this film, all the people that surround him, like the guy you're talking about, his wife, Max von Sydow.
The hostage guy was one of the best parts of the whole thing.
No, yeah. I will cede that it's well acted.
Yeah, I thought the acting in here was just great. And you didn't get a lot of it. But every time someone was on screen... They were in the set. They were in the frame. They were in the film. I love that. To make a film like this, you know, where you're so physically stationary and in this case locked in, it's a very challenging thing to do, especially for almost 2 hours. There's so many ways for this thing to lose me. It's ridiculous. It didn't. I think it's told flawlessly. Not once did it try to sneak something by me, attempt to pull up my emotions with just a bunch of sentimental crap. Every part of this film was built on something prior to. That's what I liked about it. The pace, the foundation. When the movie first opens, we're greeted with this very iconic credit roll of Somewhere Beyond the Sea, set to this parade of x-rays.
Yeah. I like the music in here, I'd say.
You had those x-rays in the background against this song, and right away you think, something didn't turn out as planned.
Right.
So even from the credits, it's continuous flow and setup and delivery, just very well hatched. The first setup scene, where the eyelid folds up like a curtain, and this is where I think it worked for me. They knew when to pull that curtain back down. Because you're strapped in with this guy. It's very effective. And I thought the same thing. When am I going to get sick of this? The minute I thought, okay, let's go pull out and let's see some more of this film from a different point of view is exactly when they did it.
I completely agree.
Yeah. I mean, I really thought to myself, like you guys, when is this going to get old? But I got to tell you, man, that great eyelid sewing scene, right?
Yeah.
Where you become trapped in with them and those sutures come down like prison bars.
Yeah.
I'd like to know how they did that, actually.
I think they actually probably put a fake eyelid in front of the thing and sewed up, but it's effective.
But it looked so real.
Yeah. I mean, it's very, very effective. It did look real, too.
It looked incredible. It's like almost like they had a camera in this guy's head and were filming from inside his eyeball. That's exactly how it looked.
And it locked you in with him. You're in here now, okay? Right. But it also lets you out, okay? I don't think anything was overplayed. You get these meaningful one-person flashbacks in this thing. Mm-hmm. Gorgeous restraint. For example, we only have one scene of him at work. That's it. We only see him at work for 10 seconds. We know who he is.
Right.
He's surrounded by models, cameras, glamour.
Lenny
Kravitz. I caught that. But
and you know that he's the guy.
Yeah, right. It just leaves it there. We aren't beat over the head with it. And that's what I'm talking about as far as restraint and giving me just what I want. It's enough to know this. This is a tragic, static life. It was once fluid and vibrant and important. And just because of that 10 seconds, we know how humbling this is going to be for him.
Right.
That's all we need to know. Another example real quick for me is the flashback scene where it's him and his father. Those two scenes are fantastic.
Yeah, me too.
And it's because of how it's set up. The one sets up the other. He's shaving him in the first one. We see the tenderness. We see the relationship. If that's not there, that second scene with the phone call, it doesn't have much weight.
Right.
Because in that first one, he ends that scene with, you know, all I want is approval from my father. So when that phone rings from the father in that second scene, now there's reason to really feel heartbreak. And the film just goes on and on like that. You know, and then we didn't need a bunch of flashbacks forced on us with the kids either. All we know about him and his relationship with his kids, he says one thing. I'm going to miss their warm bodies against me. I don't need any more than that. So the way this thing is told and the way it's put out, the pieces, the way they fit, it just had that pace. It allowed me to understand what he was thinking about. And I put his life down, and it gives you that time to put yourself into that. All of a sudden, I start thinking about how I would feel. Mm-hmm. What scenes would come back to me? And that's why it's powerful to me. It didn't force anything on me. It opened a door for me many, many times to sit there and feel what this guy was feeling. Then there's these scenes of which I thought could have gone wrong, and that's the imagination scenes in the hospital with people dancing all through the hallways. He references that in the beginning with a great setup, saying, in this hospital, this used to be a temple of art,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. And people used to dance here and perform here. So now that makes sense. And he also said two things. The only thing other than my eye that's not paralyzed is my memory and my imagination. So because of that point, then the imagination, the memory that drove this thing just made sense. It just fit. The sentimental crap's there, but they didn't put it on me.
It's not front and center.
It's not front and center. And I think I like this film because it allowed me to stop many, many times and think about myself in it. It put me in the film, and that's why I love the thing. I love the way it's told, first and foremost, and the performances.
I'm with you.
So
100%.
Hope that's not too long-winded, but I really like this film, man.
Yeah,
I'm locked in. I was locked into my review.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll tell you
Adam watched it with one eye open.
You know what we need to do? Why don't we take a quick break, man? You want to hear her reading letters back to him?
Let's hear some letters.
Let's hear some letters being read in French. You're going to get an idea of what this guy had to put up with right. And what Adam really had to put up with.
On va aller doucement. E-S-A-R-I-N-T-U-L-O-M-T-B-C.
C'est trop long. Je ne peux pas garder la paupière ouverte comme ça.
V-V-G-J-J. Je.
Bravo.
Diving Bell and the Butterfly, 2007. There's a piece of that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, during the break, Max went out and he gave himself a pencil-thin mustache. He put on a beret. He drove around the neighborhood with a bike and a basket with a big loaf of bread in the front.
Mm. A baguette.
With
a
little
puppy.
Yeah. And I looked at people and said, hong-hee-hong.
Yeah.
While he was eating fries.
All in about 30 seconds.
Right, right. And he's back now.
Okay, so let's get into the film.
Sacré bleu.
See, what did I tell you, right? Back to Max. Talk about what you got to talk about, man. One thing, two things.
To bounce a couple of things off the complaints about the alphabet scenes, I thought those were played magnificently because, okay, he's sitting here thinking, the woman's reading the alphabet and not even in order, the most commonly used right. letters. And she's thinking, God, this is ridiculous. This is going to take forever.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to take me forever just to spell out one word, like I'm hungry or something.
Right.
Yeah.
Then they go to the scene with, what was the guy's name?
I thought it was Laurent.
Laurent,
yeah.
And, you know, it's that scene where he gets the sense of humor and the guy's doing it wrong. Mm-hmm. Throughout the film, that slowly progresses to where they don't need the board anymore. They've got it down perfected. Like when he first started, he said, she's going too slow. I don't know how long I can go without blinking because his eyes getting tired. Mm-hmm. And that shows us progression throughout the movie of accepting what he's got to go through.
Yes.
And just learning to live with what he is now. That's necessary to the film.
Yeah.
You know,
the first 12 times it is.
Okay. Sure. Yeah. Well,
the next 30.
And that's his life. Much. That's nope. how the whole thing
First goes. Off, they did not do it 42 times.
Yeah.
You know, you can make that complaint about any little device they use in a movie, but when it works, it works. In this case, it worked.
You know what else it did? You never really knew how long he was in the chair. That gave you an idea that, okay, he hasn't been here a week. He's been living like this for a while. Every time they went into that, as you say, mechanism, it got quicker and tighter. It became less cumbersome. So you know he's been there a little while.
Yeah, but what did they say? A summer? I mean, a couple of months? Because at the end, in the end, it's like, it's my first autumn.
That's right. He said his first autumn. Well, whatever. He's a quick learner.
What else does he have to do?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
He sure didn't like people getting in the way of his soccer match.
Guy's trying to, terrible. That was awful when they turned the TV off on the dude. He's like, no.
Really, though, the TV was one of the worst parts of it. It's there for your... you know, comfort, really, but they had it, you know, at 2 in the morning and showed, and it's just got that static beep that he's having to just deal with.
The Indian movie.
And then they turn off the game, and he's like, oh, this is just, how bad would the, I mean, really.
Yeah, why would that guy turn the TV off? Right. Of all things you could do, you turn my TV off. Thanks, pal. I'll sit here in the dark and stare at the wall.
Yeah.
The other thing with the, kind of want to see this dubbed instead of with subtitles.
Yeah.
Because I, you know, I studied a lot of French, and I'm sitting there thinking, okay, I'm not picking up on the alphabet because she's reading it out of order. And then she'll say a letter, and then it comes up on the screen as D. I'm like, well, she didn't say D.
She didn't do them in order. She used them in the order of which they were.
I know, but my point is they have a different word for, you know, whatever, die. I want to die.
Yeah, okay, I understand what you're saying.
It would have started with an M. So she said M, and it comes up D. I'm like, what? She said M.
I understand.
I was doing the same thing.
Oh, okay, I see what's difficult.
But it's what you get for watching a foreign film.
Yeah.
You know, you just look at it from a different point of view.
Yeah, but they don't often spell things in foreign movies. Okay, so I was like, wow, I got to really wrap my head around this.
Real quick, now we've talked a lot about how that worked, that mechanism, as you say. What about the performances real quick? Because I'm high on that.
They were fantastic.
Did they work for you as well as they did for me?
The guy was great. Everybody was goodness. Yeah. And going back to the Max von Sydow scenes with his dad.
Yeah.
That scene where he made the phone call, that's the one that just, it almost tore me up.
Yeah, I'll give you that. That was a good scene.
I think the shaving scene was the best one. You could tell it was a strained relationship, and that was such an intimate moment.
Yeah.
And when he left, he touches his dad's face, and I was like, oh, wow, when's the last time I touched my dad's face? What a weird thing.
Did you get the sense that he had far more memories that weren't pleasant? And that's why he whipped out that one. That's the one he wanted to recall the most.
I got it. I took from it that most of his relationships were pretty strained.
Yeah.
And he was kind of going through everything, even with his kids, his wife, girlfriend, everything was just strained. And he's just sitting there not able to make amends for anything. I think it actually says that.
So, yeah, he said. I think he does say that.
So, yeah. So I think that that's the whole point of the book. I haven't read it.
Yeah,
I probably will. I mean, why not? What's the worst that could happen?
I read the movie, so the books.
You read the movie, so the books.
There you go.
And you brought up earlier where they were showing the little flashbacks of his life. I don't consider everything in here of quote unquote a memory of his. It's just showing little flashbacks of his life to kind of set up what he was. Mm-hmm. That little scene where they show him at the photo shoot. I watched that and I said, is this going to be one of those redemptive stories?
Yeah.
Yeah,
where the guy's just a total jerk. Am I going to have to see scenes of him
you
know, lighting a cigarette and being drunk and pushing his girlfriend in the face up against a wall and running out and carousing and then see a scene of him ignoring his kids? And you got the sense that he was sort of a jerk, but they didn't really overplay that, I don't think.
Yeah,
he was more snooty.
I think it was. I think he came across as a little bit more snooty than
it's
just
called French.
Snotty jerk.
Called French.
Oh, don't. Yeah, tell me not to make
enough of that.
Tell me not to make fun of the French.
There was a sense of an air about him apparently at one point where this couldn't happen to him. This wasn't going to happen to him. He was above the fray.
I'm above this. I'm the editor of French Elle.
Yeah, no, he was definitely an alpha male kind of thing.
Well, let's go over to the ultimate alpha male, and that's James Hartsup Savage. And we'll round it out with Hoodie here at the end. But
I love the scenes with the father, because the first scene, the shaving scene, which I really like, that's probably that and the phone call are probably my two favorite scenes in this film, because that shaving scene is where you're pulled out of that one-eyed camera vision. You know, it's like the first-person shooter game. You know, it's like I can't stand that stuff. The performances were very well done. Unfortunately, a lot of the performances were done with face mugging into the camera of this one eye.
I wrote that down. James' problem with the fourth ball.
Yeah.
I did not see that.
It's just, you know, how certain things hit certain people. This is just how it hit me. Once it pulled back out and you got the scene with Max von Sydow, who I didn't know spoke French so well. You know?
Maybe he does.
Yeah. No, apparently he does.
Maybe he learned along with Schnable. Maybe they took Rosetta Stone together.
Right.
We don't know.
Right. I thought I was like room to breathe, really. And maybe that was the intended effect. It was like the claustrophobic feeling of the diving bell, thus, you know, the name. And then once you're out of that, you can like breathe. This constraining viewpoint is out. So I really liked that. And I really thought it was a real touching moment, like you said, with the touching of the face and how his father forgot, you know. And then the phone call was just heartrending. That was a really heartrending scene where she had to recite the alphabet and he's forgotten what he's asked him on the phone because it takes so long to respond.
E-S-A-R-I-N-T-U-L. Ne pleure pas.
Non. C'est facile à dire. Tu es mon fils, nom de Dieu. Oh, wow. Jean-Dominic. Non, je me souviens. C'est bientôt ton anniversaire. Je m'appellerai.
Bon anniversaire.
Ça ne doit pas être facile pour un père de parler à un fils quand on sait trop bien qu'il ne va pas vous répondre.
Yeah, but his dad also showed a kind of a selfishness that I can't do this. I don't have enough patience for this. When his son, of course, has, I mean, all the stuff that he's had to go through to actually learn how to do this thing. This is his only means of communication.
But that was just a defense mechanism. I think he was trying to say that because he knew he would forget.
Well, also, he was just completely crazy upset about what happened.
Yeah.
It wasn't in your face, you know. It was just him, like, kind of, I can't do this. I can't do this. Meaning, you know, he's saying, I can't communicate with you like this, but what he's really saying, obviously, is like, I can't imagine that this has happened to you.
And goodbye.
And there was so much, you know, in that scene, you're supposed to feel awfully sad for the lonely person, the one that's being left alone, him, Bauby, in that scene. I found that sentiment being tossed over to the father in that. He was the lonely one. He was the one being left alone.
Right. Yeah.
And the regret fell on him, and I like the way they twisted that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about?
Mm-hmm, very much.
Hoodie, what do you have as far as a favorite scene goes? When the film ends, you look back, you remember what?
One of my favorite scenes is when he first sees himself walking through the hallway. He's looking at himself in the glass on the wall. I thought that was fantastic. What a great way to first, you know, have him recognize what he's become and the distortion and all that. Yeah. I thought that was fantastic. My, oddly enough, the favorite scene of the whole movie was the end credits. I know Adam's going to love that one. But with the glaciers breaking off and going in reverse, that's my favorite part of the whole movie. I don't know. They did that in the middle of the movie where they had the glaciers breaking off and all that. But to have that be put back together at the end, I thought that's the most perfect way to end this thing. And I watched all the credits just so I could sit and watch.
Yeah, I did too.
And I thought that was just gorgeous. The blues and the reds that were happening and the speed at which they were falling, you know, it wasn't exactly slow motion, but it wasn't as slow motion as I'm used to. I just thought the whole thing was just fantastic.
Oh, while we're talking to you, I wanted to ask you something about this film. Obviously says he's basically an atheist.
Right.
But then he starts to, and I think a lot of people would, regardless of their faith, you start to question things. You start to double check things, okay? He kind of double checks that premise. He thinks back about the time he went to see the whatever. What was that?
He went to Lord. Yeah.
Okay, there. He went there. He started toying with the idea of religion again. He didn't get captured by it. He basically said, I'm not going to deny someone else praying for me, but I just can't go there with him. But he kind of messed with that premise. How'd you like that?
I liked it a lot, actually. It wasn't preachy at all. Yeah. It was just a little snap in the middle of the movie. I said, I get it. I like it. Up to that point, he had a lot of the nurses saying, I'm thinking about you. I'm praying for you. Yeah. I'm very devoted. Mm-hmm. And then that scene that where he went to Lord, that didn't take place until... Yeah, that was pretty mid-late film.
Yeah,
that
was later in the movie.
So he goes to Lord and, like I said, atheist, just to skip right to it, goes to the shop. He doesn't want to buy this thing. You look at the guy who's selling it to him, he knows he's got him by those things.
By his girlfriend.
I don't know how you say those things in French.
The short hairs.
His escargots.
Yeah, those things. So he ponies up $1,300 and then goes on for a walk that night and sees the same statue that's one of a kind that he just purchased.
Yeah,
right.
And that kind of harked back to, miracles are trinkets. Right, bottom line.
That's it. This won't save me either.
Yeah, right. And that was very well placed, and it wasn't preachy to me. I thought it was great.
Adam, you have anything you want to add? You've been sitting over there. I don't think you want to talk about this film. What you got?
I like the blinking Jesus.
The blinking Jesus.
It was the blinking Madonna, right?
It was a blinking Jesus.
Was it a Jesus or is it a Madonna?
I have no idea.
I'm talking about the little picture on the... Never mind.
Do you realize his favorite part of this film was the blinking Jesus? That is fantastic.
It was suturing the eyelid.
Oh, that's right. Suturing the
eyelid. It was those two scenes. That's it.
I do want to talk... I want to harp back to what Max was saying about... We said that it started getting a little bit into the too romantic line. Mm-hmm. You mentioned a scene earlier. We need to get back to that. Because for me, that happened more than a couple times. And the one biggest was when she was on, they're on the boat and he's doing Monte Cristo, having that read to him. I was like, eh.
Yeah, yep. I forgot about that. Yeah, that's sort of,
It was nice, but at the same time, I'm like, okay.
Yeah. I think it did dip a little bit into that in a couple spots, but they were very fleeting moments. Overall, it didn't have that much of an impact on me as far as my feeling about how the overall story was played out. Now that you bring that up, I think about it. Yeah, that was sort of a... Yeah, I know the guy loves...
Yeah, but that was...
kind of Monte Cristo.
Don't you think that those were establishing things to establish...
That was very late in the movie to be established.
No, I mean, but to establish how fluid his life was and how full it was and to how trapped it is. So just,
I think that scene was more to establish how close those two had gotten in their relationship.
Yeah. Okay.
You know,
that's
she,
a good call.
She was like, "Whoa, it's not a first edition, but it's pretty old."
Yeah.
It's like, well, wow, she went so far as to consider even getting a first edition, which a first edition of Count of Monte Cristo must cost a lot.
Right.
Yeah.
It is one of the only scenes, too, that a lot of these sentimental scenes that, like we were talking about, they kind of end on a sour note. And the one I'm thinking of is when he spends the day at the beach with his kids. That's really nice. Yeah. And then they're in the room. They all say goodbye, and then they close the door, and then it just holds on him in an empty room for a bitter three to five seconds.
The thing that killed me about that scene was they said, "Bye, Dad, bye, Dad, bye, Dad," and then they all turned their back, walked out, attempted to close the door, and then the door swung back open.
Right.
Yeah, I caught that.
It was almost like you were expecting them to come back in the room.
Right.
And then, like you said, it just froze on that. Right. Yeah. 15 seconds.
I think that's one of the things that really tempered the sentimentality of the movie was that a lot of these sentimental scenes ended with a very bitter taste.
Yeah, they did. And we're talking about the 2007 film, Diving Bell and the Butterfly.
I don't think they ended on a...
I
wouldn't say a bitter note. I think they ended on a more realistic note. When you're watching a movie like this, you're so conditioned for the wife or the girlfriend to come back and give them an extra kiss and say, "Oh, I just wanted to tell you I loved you again and we'll be back tomorrow." That didn't happen. It's realistic. Right. That's when somebody leaves, that's what they do. They leave.
They actually walk away.
They actually walk away and they're gone.
Right.
And the door might swing open and you have that hopeful second where she might come back and give me another kiss, or maybe be my hot therapist or something like that.
But it's also the illusion of no hope. Right.
Oh, yeah.
Did you notice also, too, every time there was music in this thing, it just ended abruptly, like someone slammed the door. Boom. Yeah. And it was like, okay, here's the reality. Reality's here now. Right. It never faded out. It never played the idea that this is just all sentimental. It slammed reality in the face many, many times. What do you guys say? You want to wrap this thing up? Any last thoughts?
I like the car.
He liked the car.
It's a good car. I actually kind of like the ending scene there where he...
They had the stroke?
Yeah.
Did you really?
And for those who don't know, it was a 95 Jaguar XJS.
All right. Nice.
So you like the part where he gets his eye sewn up. You like the part where he has a stroke.
You like the flashy Jesus.
And you like the blinking Madonna.
Nice.
Jesus.
In other words, this movie needed more Full Metal Alchemist or something.
Right.
Yeah.
Or a Motel 6 or something.
Hey, did you notice also that don't most of these films start out with the guy complete, he's whole, and then the tragedy happens, then you see what happens after the tragedy?
That's a really good point.
I just thought of this. This was pretty much told in reverse of what is typical, right?
That's a great point.
I mean, usually you see the accident in the beginning, then the guy's sick, and there he is. He's
very lineal. Nicely not lineal. Linear.
It's linear, but
it's not made of lentils.
Yeah, but it's reverse sequential.
There you go.
You know what? That's a French word, too. You look it up.
All right.
Okay. I'm talking about reverse, not sequential.
Oh. Damn it.
But let's go forward. Let's go forward. That is our 2007 Butterfly. What did I say?
Diving Bell and the Butterfly.
That's how I've done that.
This or as I like to call it, the Diving Bell and the Papillon. For those who don't speak French, that's Butterfly.
I still don't believe them. Diving Bell and the Butterfly, 2007. That's what we thought of that. This inspired something. Our top three, My Body is a Prison movie. Gumbo Johnson, this is yours, man. Number three, My Body is a Prison film. What you got? My God.
I'm going to have to go The Fly.
What about the fly in this movie landed on the guy's nose?
That was a pretty irritating fly.
That was a pretty good fly.
He looked like Jeff Goldblum, too. Did you see that?
It felt so bad for him. I was like, God, somebody get that fly off this guy's nose.
Can you imagine how annoying that would be to have a fly in the end of your nose?
I mean, it depends on if you can feel it.
Oh, you can tell he could feel it.
Interesting. That's an interesting tie-in to the film. I didn't think about this. Nice.
The fly. Maybe that was Jeff Goldblum on his nose.
Maybe it was.
Help me.
But yeah, fly, number three. The guy was totally trapped by his body. Couldn't leave his place. Couldn't do nothing.
Matthew St. Hoodie, what's your number three?
I had a tricky time with this one.
Did you really?
Yeah, go figure. I said Black Swan. I don't know.
Nice.
Oh,
that's a good answer. Did you like that film?
I did. I liked it a lot.
You damn right you did.
Yeah.
I liked the film, too. I went and saw that with Adam.
I'm going old school. Boris Karloff in 1932, The Mummy.
Yeah, of course it is.
Yeah.
The Mummy.
He was trapped in his body.
He was all wound up in all that cloth, too. That's like double trapped.
He was so uptight.
You know what my number three is?
No, you hadn't told us yet.
Nice body, but it was still a prison. That's Boxing Helena.
I thought about that.
Oh, remember that? Seen that creepy film? Who's seen it? Buddy?
I've seen
it. I know of it. Adam loves that movie and may have put it on the list.
Uh-oh.
It's my number one.
Uh-oh. I didn't consider it could be, but yeah, that's up here.
I figured it would be Human Centipede or something.
Yeah, that one takes the road to Adam's brain for sure.
It was such a bad movie, though.
It was bad. Julian Sands.
Yeah, boy, but it was creepy. An interesting concept.
Okay. Cutting a woman up and putting her in a box is an interesting concept. Yeah.
I can see. I can think of plenty of movies with interesting concepts that were bad movies.
Right.
Adam, you're a great concept. Sorry. You are a fantastic concept. What's number three?
First movie that came to mind while watching this, Johnny Got His Gun.
I don't know it.
I've never seen it. That's the only reason I didn't put it on my list.
Most people know it from the one video by Metallica.
Yeah. Have you actually seen
it? Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I watched it after I saw the video.
I thought about Metallica. That, too. I didn't know the movie.
I read the book.
Let's go to Max Gumbo Johnson, number two, My Body is a Prison Film. Go.
Freaks, Todd Browning.
Never heard
of
this.
You've never heard of Freaks.
Old school.
Oh, okay, the old, the Freak Circus people.
The one he made after Frankenstein.
One of us. That one, sure, okay. Freaks was...
And if I had to pick one freak,
terrible.
It's the black guy with no arms and no legs. And
he could roll his own cigarette.
But he could roll his own cigarette. That was crazy.
Am I wrong, though? The people in that film, the freaks, they didn't act like they were too upset with their circumstances. A lot of them accepted who they were. Did you see this film, Sam?
I did. I have seen it, and it is creepy, and it is freaky, but it's... But no, they were community.
They were making bank too.
Yeah.
When you're on other freaks, you're not so freaky.
Yeah, but when you see no arms, no legs crawling at you with a dagger in his mouth, it's
the
freaky.
Under the carriage scene.
Oh God, that is incredibly creepy.
Matthew St. Hoodie,
so scary.
Haven't seen it. No,
you're slightly freaky. Freak me out with your number two.
Kind of dinky.
Freak me out, man. Number two. What?
I got Eternal Sunshine. I think I'm gonna try to find a way to put that on every list.
I think you should. Was that rated R?
Probably.
We could have used that.
I think it was.
Leads us over to James Hartsub Savage. We're talking about our top three films inspired by the film we talked about, 2007, Diving Bell and the Butterfly. Top three My Body is a Prison films. What's your number two?
John Hurt and The Elephant Man.
Of course.
Yeah.
There goes my
he kind of lived his life in a tuxedo and a bag over his head, but he was still trapped.
Nicely done. Am I up to number two? I am, aren't I?
You're at number two.
I'm number two.
This is Michael's number two.
I'm going to go with not so much a freak, not so much a disfigurement. I'm going large or I'm going home. I'm going with What's Eating Gilbert Grape, his mom.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
She was trapped not only in her body, it was her house.
Right.
You know, when you're calling the construction crew before the hospital to get to the hospital to knock down a wall, you're trapped.
Yeah, you need to reevaluate some things.
Well, that's why the sheriff knew she meant business when she was in the police department.
Didn't even think
of that. Are we up to number two for Adam? Yeah, number two. What you got?
I'm going to go Rear Window.
Absolutely.
It's not bad.
I don't know that.
Rear Window? Hitchcock?
Hitchcock?
Jimmy Stewart?
My bad.
Raymond Burr?
This is the murder, and he can't move.
I've already said I don't know it.
Wow.
Sorry.
You should watch that. I'll get right on that.
That's a great film.
It's a great movie.
Yeah.
One of the greatest.
What about one of the greatest number ones ever to one of these questions, and that's yours right now? What is it?
I'm not changing my vote. The Elephant Man, number one.
Got to be The Elephant Man.
It is the quintessential bad body movie.
What? No Left Foot Love? What's going on?
I already used that on a list. And
I'm going number one.
Too obvious, I thought.
Wait, what did you just say?
I said No Left Foot Love?
You know, I left it off purposely. I did.
That was on my list last for Amelie, so I didn't want to use it again.
All right.
Well. Actually, that really should be up there.
Yeah.
Okay. I think it made James.
Is that your number one?
No, it's not my number one.
Oh.
Well, it's in here now.
Well, go ahead. Just jump on it, Savage. What's your number one?
My number one is Rogue from X-Men.
Rogue.
I don't like that answer.
That's awful. But
no, she can't touch anybody.
I know Rogue superpowers.
You could have went with Jason from X-2.
I was thinking of Rebecca Romaine Stamos. No, I know what you're talking about. You're talking about Anna Paquin.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good answer.
Yeah, she can't touch anybody.
You can't touch this.
Nah.
Right. Okay. Rogue, number one. Her body is a prison.
Mine's not any better. I got The Machinist. You guys seen that?
Oh, wow, The Machinist.
Getting bad.
Yeah.
That dude's crazy skinny.
Yeah, that's a prison.
God, that is a skinny,
that movie
skinny
did not live up to its hype.
Did we go to your number one yet?
Not yet.
Well, reveal it.
I thought he already did.
No, I'm changing mine.
Oh, what is it?
Monkey Shines.
What the hell is a Monkey Shines? What is this?
It's a Stephen King.
Stephen King book directed by George Romero. The guy's quadriplegic and he trains a monkey to kill.
I'm going
to
go with that. Boy. You could also go Misery if you want to go Stephen King. He's trapped in his crooked legs.
There's a bunch of movies you could go with.
Right.
Got to narrow them down. You the Wolfman, yeah, American Werewolf in London.
That's on my list.
We talked about Mask. That was a great one.
Mask.
Mask is good, yeah. Mask is good. Yeah.
I had 12 Monkeys, Chinatown, for whatever reason.
Chinatown.
Okay. Yeah, with her at the...
With the baby.
No, mother-daughter.
The mother-daughter thing. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah. Any of the Draculas.
Shutter Island. And I even had Elysium. Yeah, he's about to die.
Tell you what, we put this out on Twitter like we always do. We had a big response for this.
Yeah.
I want to knock out a few key ones, though. Some newcomers. I'm going to call this new.
Sure.
This is our newcomer to Twitter
suggestions.
Yeah. We love all our regular contributors.
We call this
they still
But let somebody else take a turn, for Christ's sake.
Yeah, sure. This is our casting call. You came up
there
with
There you go.
This is our Twitter casting call. We put this out there. We want to see what you can come up with. Get creative. See what we missed here. Lee West at LeeWest82 did. He said A Nightmare on Elm Street.
I guess we can't sleep.
Yeah, well, I guess so. Yeah, right.
I see where he's going. That body,
I see where he's going.
That sleepy body is a prison.
Right. Yeah, you got to stay awake.
Zach Miller at Zach Miller. Didn't dig the film, but Escape from Tomorrow. He also said Jacob's Ladder and Stay.
Jacob's Ladder, I almost
yeah,
put that on my list.
He's trapped in there.
I got to watch that again. That one
I do
was
too.
Weird
that,
to me.
I didn't like it the first time I saw it.
They're remaking it.
You know what? It's an Adrian. Are they really? That's a bad idea. It's an Adrian Lin film. Adrian Lin film. It's on Netflix. Huh? Who knows? Who knows what could happen? Have you seen this film, Hoodie?
No.
Oh, God. We might have to talk about that. Let's talk about how you say this person's name. That's a beautiful name. Biagia Scanella. She says
that's Italian.
That's fantastic sounding. Biagia Scanella. Welcome to the queue
for you.
She says, does The Shining work?
I'd say so. He was trapped in his own mind. He was taken over by the ghostesses.
Trapped in a hotel in a maze.
If he was in a different body, he'd have been better off.
Probably.
I don't know.
Maybe the ghosts are trapped there.
Charles Whiteman. I like his answer. Charles Whiteman, a snob of film, says, Memento. 15 seconds later. Memento. Once again, Zach Miller at Zach Miller says, depending on your reading, you'll like this. Under the Skin. We wouldn't seen that ponderous
Under the
film.
Skin.
Oh, yeah. Jesus.
Trapped in her own body.
What? That was a great movie. You're
ponderous,
crazy.
Right.
Ponderous.
You know what? Next, define ponderous right now. Well, I think you're just throwing a word out there. You have no idea what it means.
Oh, I know what it means.
Moving on to the next film, and we'll put this one to sleep. This was 2007. Once again, Diving Bell and the Butterfly. Our family plan. Thank you, Kim.
Family. Thanks, Kim.
Down in Florida, you say.
Love you, Kim.
I love you, too, Kim. I don't know you, but God, I love you. I love you because you gave me a film to watch that I love talking about.
And we wrap up the family plan.
We wrap up the family plan next week with Matthew St. Hoodie.
Yay.
it's growing on you.
You know what, though? This film had a relationship between a father and a son.
True that.
And so there's another tie-in. It's a stretch, but father and son.
Yeah,
it's
my
dad man.
Picked the movie.
What is it?
Night Train to Lisbon, 2013.
I haven't seen it. I haven't seen it.
Never seen it. Never even heard of it.
Yeah, my dad said it's excellent.
All right.
To see it.
Okay.
So,
Salazar. Do you trust that?
Yeah, my dad's got pretty decent taste.
Okay. I've seen it. I've already seen it.
Oh, you have?
I did.
Do I have to read this movie?
Well, I'll tell you what you should do. You should read about Salazar in Portugal.
Don't do it, Adam.
Just watch the movie.
Just watch the film.
Go into it blind.
Can I give you one spoiler? Jeremy Irons talks with an English accent.
Whoa.
I can't do it. Wow. I can't do this. I gotta call my dad.
So that's Night Train to Lisbon 2013. What's your dad's name?
T-Bone.
He's gonna hate that.
Thanks, T-Bone.
Is your dad's name T-Bone?
Yes. Yes, it
His
is.
His name is Trent, but
T-Bone.
When I'm drunk, I call him T-Bone and he hates that.
That's T-Bone Hoodie. T-Bone Hoodie. Cues up Night Train to Lisbon.
Oh man,
I like that.
Yeah, that's how you say it.
I think we said it.
To Lisbon.
That's next week. You know, I like this too. We're gonna put on a little bit of pseudo intellectual. I'm gonna come in with my brown tweed jacket.
Yeah, we better put on a good show. My dad will be listening. So
it'll probably be ponderous.
I'm gonna wear patches on my sleeve.
Oh, me too. I'm gonna
smoke
do that.
A pipe.
Yeah. I'm gonna wear glasses that don't have a prescription in them.
I'm gonna smell like pipe tobacco. Yeah. So that's you get the idea. It's
yeah.
We'll talk about that next week. That's it for this show though. 2007 Diving Bell Butterfly. It's on Netflix. You want to watch it? You're more than welcome to. I say go for it. Yeah, so there you go. This is the cue. Next week we'll see you. Till then, take care, stay safe, and we'll see you then.
My body is a cage that keeps me from dancing with